Do sit down. As Chancellor of the University, I declare this congregation open for the conferring of degrees by the authority of the Senate and of the Council.
High Sheriff of Leicestershire, parents, friends, and graduands, as Vice Chancellor, I am delighted to welcome you all to this degree congregation. It is a celebration for all those who graduate today. We celebrate your many achievements that culminate in the award of a degree from a major international research and teaching-led university. While you have been with us, the university has developed and changed. We are now a community of 19,000 students and 3,000 staff with a turnover of over £200 million. We are a big business with higher education at its heart. The university has celebrated its 50th anniversary this academic year. It is a major milestone, and we have reflected this in many events, including these degree ceremonies, where we are awarding honorary degrees to several people who are closely connected to us. This academic year, we have been very proud of a number of our achievements. Leicester's research grants have increased by more than 50% to £54 million, which places us well within the UK's top 20 research-intensive universities. Leicester's research has also been shown to have the greatest impact of any Midlands university and the 10th greatest impact in England. This is established in an independent survey conducted by Evidence for the Guardian newspaper. In June, Leicester was named as one of only seven institutions in the UK to lead a £20 million National Institute for Health Research. The university is also one of 10 institutions specially selected to lead work on employer engagement through the provision of flexible, bespoke education for employees. Applications this autumn for this autumn's entry are now up by 17%, and we have the highest scores for overall satisfaction among full-time students at mainstream universities in England. The synergy between teaching and research in this university is reflected in the development of our new £32 million library, which opened in April, bringing together exciting space for undergraduates, postgraduates, and staff. For those parents and friends who are here today, I do recommend that your sons and daughters take you to the library so as to show you where they've spent many happy hours in their university career, and I'm sure that you will be very impressed with our building. Now, all this leads to our positioning in the league tables, and league tables have been published during the last 2 months. In May, Leicester was placed in 12th position in the Independence Good University Guide. In June, it was placed in 14th position in The Guardian, and in The Times, 2 or 3 weeks later, also placed in 14th position out of 130 universities. Now, I've carefully checked the data that they use to construct these league tables, and I feel obliged to say to you that the most reliable league table this year is clearly that provided by the Independent. But what contributes to our league table position? In the last year, Leicester staff have engaged in many leading activities. In historical studies, we were delighted to read in the Queen's Birthday Honours list that Professor Chris Dyer had been awarded a CBE for services to scholarship. In politics, staff are developing a new distance learning programme in international relations. And in the School of Archaeology and Ancient History, there have been many achievements this year. The school celebrated its 50th anniversary since its inception. The school has formed a new Centre for Historical Archaeology. New master's programmes are being made available in the Classical Mediterranean Studies, Archaeology and Landscape, and Historical Archaeology. And a decision to offer full undergraduate degrees in archaeology by distance learning has also been taken. But most particularly, we were delighted about 2 weeks ago when I received a letter from the Leverhulme Trust saying that an interdisciplinary team led by Professors Lynn Foxall in Ancient History and Professor Jose Fiadero in Computer Science, with staff from Museum Studies and Computer Science, had won a grant of £1.7 million to focus on networks of craftspeople and crafts traditions. Exciting research for the coming years. Now, in order to support the work of our staff and students, we have developed high-quality facilities. In the past 3 years, we have completed a number of projects totalling a capital spend of around £70 million. It includes our £32 million library development, which has also provided us with not only a new library, but also a 500-seater lecture theatre. We opened earlier in the year a £23 million hall of residence named after our former Chairman of Council, John Foster, and this provides 581 study bedrooms. We have spent £2 million on refurbishing and improving laboratories in the medical school, and as you will see on campus, we are nearing completion of the cleaning and repair of the external facade of the Attenborough Tower as part of a £2.2 million full window replacement programme. Nevertheless, there is no shortage of projects for us to work on in the capital programme. And right at the top of our list for next academic year is a new £15 million refurbishment of the Percy G Students' Union building. Just as we feel there is a wow factor with the new library, so I would like there to be a wow factor when you go in the student union. And I hope that in the next 2 years we shall set about making that happen. We will also be constructing new state-of-the-art teaching space. The Campus Energy Conservation Programme goes ever forward in order to improve our carbon footprint, and a new development framework plan will provide a framework for the development of the university over the next 5, 10, 15 and 20 years. If the figures in this plan are to be believed, we will be investing a further £786 million in the university in the next 10 to 20 years. We also make very significant contributions to the community through voluntary work conducted by students. We are especially proud of the fact that this year we estimate 2,500 students have been actively involved in volunteering in the city and the county. One of the organisations that regularly provides volunteering facilities is the organisation Contact. It runs holidays for children who would otherwise not get a holiday. It makes and constructs adventure playgrounds. It does a whole range of activities, but most importantly, it is involved in the Right to Read scheme in the city and the county. And over the last 4 years, 278 students have volunteered at 40 city and county primary schools with projects and after-school clubs and enterprise days. Those of you who have helped younger students in schools in these various ways will have empowered them greatly. They will always remember you, and they will be forever grateful for the help and support you have provided. Our work in the university never stops. We are creating plans for new research, new teaching programmes and new community links. It all goes to demonstrate that we are a dynamic university. However, any university requires multi-million pound investments for new buildings, laboratories, classrooms and equipment, and Leicester is no exception. Over the past 3 years, the university has invested over £80 million in its estate. This has been funded by the university's own money through government grants, loans, and also donations. It is therefore essential that government funding continues to help transform our university system. It is very evident that there has been a huge transformation across the sector, but this funding needs to be placed alongside our own fundraising efforts. And I hope you will wish to continue to support your university in many different ways through our Alumni Association. We hope you will keep in touch with the university, and I shall look forward to meeting you at alumni events. Finally, I would like to congratulate you all on the degrees you have obtained. But before I close, I would just like to briefly tell you about what has become known over the years as the Vice Chancellor's competition. Basically, each year we have a competition between the faculties to see who can applaud loudest and longest in these degree ceremonies. Now, last year, arts came very close to winning. But this year, I noticed, I don't know what's gone on among the deans and the academic registrar, but all the faculties seem to be combined one with another. Arts and social studies have joined together. And I do wonder whether it's, you know, arts have persuaded social science to join them just to see if they can clinch it over the medical school this year. So I would now like to invite you to join me in showing your appreciation to your parents, relatives, friends, and sponsors who have supported you through the university. So I would now ask the graduating class of 2008 to join with me in a round of applause for all those people. Well, that's very good, but just a tip from someone who's been here a year or two, loud as well as long. Have an absolutely splendid day, applaud your fellow students, and all good wishes to you throughout your future careers.
Greville Janner, Lord Janner of Braunstone, is a lawyer by profession, a Queen's Counsel who took silk in 1971. For 27 years, from 1970 until 1997, he sat in the House of Commons in the Labour interest as the MP for the Leicester North West and then West constituency. For the last 10 years, he has been an active member of the House of Lords. Greville Janner was born in Cardiff in 1928. He will celebrate his 80th birthday in 2 days' time. In the early part of the war, he was evacuated to Canada together with his sister because it was learnt that their father was on Hitler's death list. He returned to Britain in 1944 to finish his schooling at St Paul's School in London before being called up to do his national service. He served in the Royal Artillery as part of the British Army of the Rhine, reaching the exalted rank of sergeant and working as our youngest war crimes investigator. He then read law at Trinity Hall, Cambridge, where in 1952 he was president of the union and chairman of the University Labour Club. He was called to the bar by the Middle Temple in 1954 and joined chambers at One Garden Court in the Temple. These had a general practice, and Greville Janner acquired a wide experience of most branches of the law. He especially enjoyed criminal cases and became heavily involved in employment law. Greville Janner always wanted to enter politics. He fought his first parliamentary election in 1955 at Wimbledon, an unwinnable seat for Labour, but very good training. In 1970, he was selected as candidate for the North West Leicester constituency, in succession to his father, Sir Barnet Janner, who had held it since 1945. You may note that Sir Barnet Janner and his wife are commemorated in this university by a travel scholarship in their names. Greville Janner was duly elected and served as the MP for Leicester North West and then Leicester West until his retirement in 1997. He never held ministerial office because his wife believed that it would destroy their family life, but he was a very active backbench constituency MP. He was a member of the Select Committee on Employment for 14 years and its chairman from 1992 to 1996. He spoke frequently in the House of Commons and asked many questions. Hansard lists a remarkable 2,663 entries. He campaigned for several years on behalf of a disabled constituent, introducing a private member's bill in a successful attempt to change the law on disability allowances. He campaigned strongly in 1972 and later for government assistance to this city as it struggled to absorb some 20,000 refugees from Uganda and Kenya. He also suffered an industrial injury as an MP. In January 1978, whilst opening new leisure facilities in Braunstone Park, he fell off his skateboard. There is a photograph in the Times of January the 7th, if you don't believe me. I should perhaps remind Lord Janner that skateboarding is forbidden on the university site. On the wider political stage, Greville Janner has long campaigned for compensation and restitution for Holocaust victims and was instrumental in arranging the 1997 London conference on Nazi-looted gold. He was president of the Board of Deputies of British Jews from 1979 to 1985. Lord Janner has also, throughout his career, sought to foster good relations between different faiths. His book, One Hand Alone Cannot Clap, An Arab-Israeli Universe, is a testament to this work. In 2005, he founded, together with Prince Hassan bin Talal of Jordan, the Political Council for Coexistence, which brings together Jewish and Muslim parliamentarians from around the world. They remain its joint presidents. Greville Janner is a prolific author and broadcaster. In addition to innumerable articles, he has published some 70 books. The British Library catalogue lists 105, including revised editions. These include manuals on presentational skills and public speaking, and include Janner on Speechmaking, which I have read with enjoyment and, possibly, profit. However, most of his books are handbooks and textbooks on the law, intended for the business and educational worlds. These have had a wide sale, possibly because, as he says in the preface to the Employer's Guide to the Law on Health, Safety and Welfare at Work, students should find enough material in these pages to enable them to sail through some of their examinations. Students worldwide have profited from Janner's books. King Fahd University in Saudi Arabia has 5 titles in its library. Harvard University also values his work. They have 12 of his titles. The Library of the University of Texas has 15. Singapore University has 21. Our library contains 6. Truly, as St. Matthew wrote, the prophet is not without honour, save in his own country. My heart warms to a lawyer who can include, in a guide to the law for employers, a chapter entitled The Art of Passing the Buck. A chapter which begins, "The Act places a new and shining premium on passing the legal buck." Janner is entertaining as well as informative. Today, in the city he served so well for so long, we are proud to honour a lawyer, parliamentarian, and friend of humanity. Mr. Chancellor, on the recommendation of the Senate and of the Council, I present Lord Janner of Braunstone that you may confer on him the honorary degree of Doctor of Laws.
Sir, I think you've got to get rather many medical questions. Thank you very much. Take a bow.
Mr. Chancellor, Vice-Chancellor, professors, ladies and gentlemen, I came here on my skateboard this morning and just managed to arrive in time. And I am honored and delighted to be here to receive the honorary doctorate. I should tell you that when I was at university, I got a 2-2. So do you have 2-2s, any of you? Yes, or you all get 2-1s or first, do you? No, he's nodding his head. He gets a first. Yes. Well, I thank Dr. German for his very kind and flattering epitaph. And I wish that everyone who spoke about me did so with such generosity and goodwill. I'm delighted to return to Leicester, where my father and I, between us, were so happy to serve as local MPs for over half a century. And I came today with a man sitting up in the gallery called Lord Willie Bark, who is a very distinguished Leicester citizen who was my treasurer for many years and who is now one of the leaders in the House of Lords. He's sitting right at the front in the middle. Oh, he probably fixed that for himself. And it is very, very good. And I salute this university for its enduring excellence and the way it's in improving, with the exception of its library, which I feel very guilty about. You're not being prepared to buy my books. You're a miserable lot. They're so mean bastards, these people. I'm going to send you some, all I can find. I promise you, you tell me the 6 you got and I will try and send you the rest, and no bill with it either. No. And I thank you so much for giving a terrific start to my youthful birthday celebration. You are much blessed and appreciated, and I thank you, and I wish you all 2-1s very shortly.
The graduands in the Faculty of Arts, represented by the Dean, Professor Shatter. Will all graduates in the faculty please stand?
Mr. Chancellor, I ask you to admit these candidates from the Faculty of Arts to the several degrees for which they are presented.
Graduands in the Faculty of Arts, I admit you to the several degrees for which you are presented by the authority of the Senate.
For the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, John Cater. Judy Mead. Judith Porcasi. Judith Roston. Stephanie Van. For the degree of Master of Philosophy, Serena Frederick. For the degree of Master of Arts in Archaeology and Heritage, Jonathan Borg. Sandy Colby. Michael Evans, Janine Iverson, Gregory Farnworth Jones, Mireya Gonzalez Rodriguez, Hugh Mannell, Sandra Rutter, with the degree of Master of Arts in Social History, Tony Johns. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in American Studies, Gurpreet Bilku. Dominic Butcher. Sean Filkness Mercer. Neil Fuller. Robert Hicks. Claire Howarth. Lauren McEwen. Samuel Warren. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in American Studies with a year in the USA and winner of the American Studies Prize, Eleanor Cope. Rebecca Freer. Megan Glover. Alexander Graham. Nicholas Hussey.
Congratulations.
Charlotte Lamb. Gemma Lamb. Sarah Laycock. Winner of the American Studies Dissertation Prize, Sophie LeBrun. Corinne Logan. Dean Malpas. Winner of the American Studies Second Year Prize and the American Studies Prize, Michael Miller. Craig Morris. Tara Nickel. Matthew Roche. Nicholas Sayers. Dale Talbot. Amy Turner. Yanni Swambila. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Ancient History and Archaeology, James Belak. Caroline Codner. Peter Davis. Stephen Dickinson. Thomas Doe. Ruth Driver. Bethany Faint. Natsuhito Fuji. Rachel Gargan. Andrew Gibbons. Amy Hills. Philip Lewis. Kirsty Macklin. Gemma Philbin. David Robinson. Sarah Robinson. Kieran Shabana. Amanda Steele. Miranda Villarreal. Winner of the Garner Prize, Lindsay Whale. Jane Ballhead. Kelly Wheeler. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Ancient History and Archaeology International, winner of the Faculty Prize, Christopher Edley. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Ancient History and History, Michael Adkins. Christopher Bennett. Benjamin Buxton. Dane Carton. Samuel Grinsell. Sally Gunyon. Winner of the Dr. D.T. Williams Memorial Prize and the Arnold Wickham Gom Prize, Michael Harvey. Owen Hewitt. Winner of the Arnold Wickham Gom Prize, Lucinda Kingsnorth. Robert Milligan. Lavinia O'Brien. Kevin Parmento. Guy Sampson. Harriet Shepherd. Rhys Simons. Emily Smith. Laura Warren. David Whittingham. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Archaeology, Graham Aldred. Margaret Bennett. Rachel Bickley. Tracy Connolly. Lynn Curtis. Hannah Dyer. Carly Gilchrist. Leigh Gleason. Gemma Hicks. Joshua Hunnicet. Emma Jansen. Predrag Jovanovic. Mark Powers. Katie Tallett. Louise Robluska. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Archaeology International, Chris Attridge. For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Archaeology, Cyan Connell. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History, Edward Adams. Laura Askew. Alexander Barbett. Helen Batter. Paul Bedford. Benjamin Breeze. Francis Brennan. Victoria Bretherton. Jeremy Brindle. Paul Bullock. Sophie Bulstrode. Daniel Burke. Helen Chapman. Hannah Cockrell. Stuart Coleman. Sean Coody. Ben Cookman. Louise Coop. Eleanor Cottrell. James Davis. Ricky Datt. Marcia Donnelly. Kieran Elliott. Kate Evans. Richard Fern. Thomas Freeman. Charlene Gamblin. Sophie Gathercole. Elizabeth Gatland. Andrew Grayson. Thomas Green. Matthew Greenwood. Sarah Gray. Rachel Griffith. Winner of the Ralph Davis Prize, Tarquin Gunnell. David Hall. Katie Hall. David Harris. Michael Harvey. Jessica Healy. Catherine Henbury. Paul Hobbs. Winner of the Ralph Davis Prize, the Professor W.H. Brock Prize, and the H.J. Dias Prize, Tom Hume. Elizabeth Hunt. Christina Johnson. Winner of the F&M Kessner Prize, the Faculty Prize, the Professor J. Simmons Prize, the Professor W.H. Brock Prize, the West End Memorial Prize, and the J.H. Plum Prize, Laura Jobson.
Follow that.
Gertrude Kaur. Edward Kelly. Tom Kimber. Emma King. Rebecca Lambert. Nikolav Liebid. Timothy Luck. Alex Massey. Sophie McKay. Richard Mercer. John Mitchell. Christopher Moore.
Congratulations.
Rebecca Moore.
Congratulations.
Richard Morris. Claire Mullooly. Laura Murray. Haroon Nadat. Sarah Norman. Daniel O'Keefe O'Donovan. Lawrence Palmer. Andrew Petrie. Ian Piggott. Matthew Klemper. Chloe Preble. Matthew Pryor. Matthew Ragg. Kyle Reed. Sally Roberts. Kerry Sayers. Katrina Shearman. Rupert Smith. Paul Stadden. Rose Taylor. Stephanie Toner. Patrick Trott. Jonathan Van Kroonenberg. Mary Van Kroonenberg. Samuel Walker. Mary Weir. Courtney Wenner. Eleanor Wharton. Richard Wincup. Adam White. Claire White. Peter White. Michael Wilkinson. Jamie Wong. Jennifer Wood. James Worrell. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History, European Union, Daniel Hicks. Shamim Razak. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History and Archaeology, Cassie Kluwer. Maeve Cockrell. Philip Garrett. Talia Krieger. Alexandra Mitchell. Mary Slater. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History and Archaeology International, Thomas Ratcliffe. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in History and Politics, Mark Bollum. Gurpreet Chokar. Rebecca Dunsmore. Samuel Francis. Hussein Hajat. Mark Jones. Scott King. Nicholas McCullough. Richard Mitchell. Jack Botford. Faraz Nazir. Dahai Neal. Andrew Perry. Nathan Rees. Carla Simpson. Ben Surtees. Winner of the F&M Kessner Prize, the Professor W.H. Brock Prize, and the Medieval Research Centre Prize, Ian Thompson. Jonathan Thompson. Alan Tolhurst. Chris Ward. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Humanities, Anne Archer.
Many, many congratulations. Enjoy your day.
Nicholas Bott. Hannah Cheney. Harry Cross.
Congratulations. Enjoy your day.
Bonita Edwards.
Many congratulations.
Norman Fraser.
Congratulations.
Carl Woodley.
Congratulations.
Paul Matlock.
Congratulations.
Moira Painter.
Congratulations.
Stinson. Anne Stones. Irene Turlington. Graham Ward. Winner of the World Humanities and Humanities Prize, Sarah Younger. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in American Studies, Waleed Basma. Mr. Chancellor, I ask you to admit to the several degrees for which they are presented by my faculty those candidates who are absent.
I admit those candidates who are absent to the several degrees for which they are presented.
John Sidney Carter is a designer, painter, and sculptor. The work most familiar to members of this university is his sculpture, which has enriched the environment in which we work and study. One might characterize the form of this sculpture by noting how often the spiral is the central structure. As for the subject matter, there are three recurring themes: the sea, industrial machinery, and the human body. Now, art on a large scale requires patronage, and as the wealth of the great aristocratic patrons has declined, the gap has in some measure been filled by corporate and public patrons. Public patrons include universities, which don't have money to spare, but sometimes are able to secure other people's money to pay for commissions. In the case of one of Mr. Carter's most important works, it was Professor Burgess, our Vice Chancellor, who secured the funding to pay for the sculpture, which was commissioned at his behest for the interior of our Henry Wellcome building. The sculpture, which is called Atomica, was installed in 2005 in the stairwell of the new building. And climbing the stairs wrapped around the sculpture gives the viewer a series of continually changing perspectives on the statue. Atomica is some 10 meters high, and its polished stainless steel rods and spheres are an abstract representation of atomic structures, the microscopic building blocks of matter. As an image of the medical science conducted in the building, it could not be bettered. And as an aesthetic object in its own right, it continues to please the inhabitants of the building and those who visit it. The university has subsequently acquired a second major sculpture by John Carter. It's called Vortex, and it was originally commissioned by P&O for the building that they then occupied on Carlton House Terrace near London's Pall Mall. The nature of P&O's shipping business meant that a maritime theme was essential, and so John Carter decided that the image of a revolving screw turbine would be appropriate. The vortex of the title is the whirl of water created by the turbine. The image of the spiral moving upwards originates in Giambologna's Abduction of a Sabine Woman, which some of you will have seen in the Piazza della Signoria in Florence. Just as the figures in that statue twist upwards in a spiral, so the human figures in John Carter's sculpture are carried upwards in the vortex of the turbine. The result is a compelling image of the interconnectedness of humans and maritime machinery, and that image suited P&O's purposes admirably. What then happened was that P&O left the building, and the sculpture did not suit the redesign of the interior effected by the next tenant, a real estate investment company. John Carter and our Vice Chancellor saw an opportunity, as a result of which Hermes Real Estate Investment donated the sculpture to the University of Leicester. It now stands in front of the Henry Wellcome Building, where its new environment has transformed it into an image of the spirals of the natural world. Now, these two sculptures represent the best of John Carter's public and corporate commissions, but he also excels in other forms, notably landscape sculpture. He has exhibited four times in the university's annual summer exhibition of sculpture in the Harold Martin Botanic Garden in Oadby. Two of these statues have been particularly accomplished. One is a bronze fisherman that stood beside the garden's fish pond, and the other is Nebula, which is an early version of Atomica. His landscape sculpture includes other aquatic images, a regatta with bronze sails, a seabird, a heron, a diver, a fish form, and a wave form. John Carter is a native of Leicester. He attended Gateway Technical Grammar School, where art was his main subject. He grew up at a time when induction in a craft took the form of apprenticeships as well as training in institutions. And so at the age of 16, entered into a five-year apprenticeship as an industrial designer. He also studied at the Leicester College of Art, where he won the Best Student Award for Drawing and Painting and the Imperial Typewriters Prize for Painting. John Carter works nationally and internationally, but he remains strongly rooted in his native county of Leicestershire. That may make the maritime motifs in his work seem anomalous, but despite our distance from the sea, there is a strong link, one which is manifest in the fact that the people of the city and county of Leicester contribute more to lifeboat charities than do citizens of any other county in England. As a resident of Foxton, some 10 miles to the south of here, John Carter lives close to the boats that navigate the huge set of locks in that village. It was in Foxton that he established the Carter Design Group, of which he has been chairman for 40 years. He has been involved in supporting art in the city and in the county. He's a prominent member of the Leicester Society of Artists, which has awarded him both the Henton and Society prizes for painting. He was a governor of Loughborough College of Art and Design and assessor for graphics there from 1984 to 1997. John Carter represents himself as a Leicestershire artist to the wider world, but also serves his own county and his local university with a generosity of spirit that we all admire. Mr. Chancellor, on the recommendation of the Senate and of the Council, I present to you John Sidney Carter, that you may confer upon him the degree of Doctor of Letters.
Well, I vote for the Doctor of Letters. Congratulations, John.
Thank you, Vice-Chancellor and Chancellor, for nominating me for this prestigious award, Honorary Degree of Doctors of Letters, for my contribution to sculpture. Although I have always worked as a designer and sculptor both nationally and internationally, my roots have always been in Leicestershire. I was born in Leicester and at the age of 13 won a scholarship to the Gateway Boys' School, which in those days was a technical grammar school. Here I was introduced to the three basic trades of Leicester. Boot and shoe, we all made shoes. Hosiery, we made a pullover. And engineering, it was metalwork. But always there was art. When it came time to leave, the careers officer asked me what profession I was going to choose. And I said, I want to be a designer. I wouldn't do that, she said, you'll never earn any money. It's not a good profession. But my heart was set on it, and I persevered and got an apprenticeship as an industrial designer for 5 years. I thought I'd won the lottery, as I enjoyed those 5 years so much. I studied fine art part-time at the Leicester College of Art, whilst designing record sleeves, exhibitions, and interiors during the day. After 2 years national service in the Royal Marines, I returned and spent several years as an art director, and then set up my own company, Carter Design Group, nearly 40 years ago. I quickly acquired some wonderful clients, including Jaguar Cars, Fabergé, Revlon, Lancôme, Clark Shoes, Dior and Porsche, to name but a few. I was very focused and the company grew and is still trading today. I've always found time in a busy life to create my own personal work. So 12 years ago, I studied full-time at the Frink School of Sculpture. I enjoyed it very much and was awarded the first Frink Fellowship. I also won the competition to create a large piece of sculpture for the new P&O building at the bottom of the Mall. Sir Philip Dowson, who was president of the Royal Academy at the time, unveiled this. I also made a large sculpture for Westminster Council. Since then, I've had a number of commissions and been made a Fellow of the Royal British Society of Sculptors. My first contact with the University of Leicester was through the RBS, when I was invited to exhibit at the Harold Martin Botanic Gardens, Leicester. I've taken part in 4 exhibitions to date. These exhibitions have been an enormous success, bringing international sculpture to Leicester. It's thanks to Vice-Chancellor Bob Burgess, his enthusiasm, and lots of hard work from his team, and I'd like to congratulate them all for everything they've done for that. Through this introduction to the university, I was invited to create a new sculpture for the Henry Wellcome Building. Exciting challenge. I created a 30-foot high sculpture in my Foxton Studios, made from stainless steel. Atomica is all about atoms and is visually exciting when particularly viewed from the glass lift. Second sculpture of the Henry Wellcome Building, Vortex, stands outside the entrance and was gifted by Hermes Real Estate. This was also created at my studio, and interestingly was cast by Glenmore Foundry at Leicester in Thurmaston. I've had a great life both designing, painting and creating sculpture. My only advice to all of you who are leaving today is not only work hard, but have a dream about what you want out of life. Each individual is the master of his own destiny. Stay focused and don't give up when the going gets tough. Thank you.
Graduates in the Faculty of Social Sciences, represented by the Dean, Professor Jackson. Will all graduates in the faculty please stand?
Mr. Vice-Chancellor, I ask you to admit these candidates from the Faculty of the Social Sciences to the several degrees for which they are presented.
Graduates in the Faculty of the Social Sciences, by the authority of the Senate, I admit you to the several degrees for which you are presented.
For the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, Anne Carleton.
Congratulations. Well done. Well done.
Nitikul Chamaramran.
I wish you to do a doctor of philosophy. Well done.
David Holmes. Leslie Masters.
Congratulations.
Hamza Mohammed Saad.
Congratulations.
David Shepherd.
Congratulations.
Peter Walker.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Master of Philosophy, Rupert Featherby. For the degree of Master of Arts and Diplomatic Studies, Fatin Al-Rahawi.
Congratulations.
Betty Moniki.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Master of Arts in English Local History, Carol Cambers.
Congratulations.
Nika Hirosu.
Congratulations.
Joint winner of the Richard McKinley Prize, Peter Jennings.
Congratulations.
Malcolm Muir.
Congratulations.
Philip Ramsey.
Congratulations.
Frida Raphael.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Master of Arts in English Local History by individually supervised study and joint winner of the Richard McKinley Prize, Hubertus Drobner.
Congratulations, well done on your prize.
Andrew Wagger.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Master of Arts in International Relations and World Order, Jalpa Patel.
Congratulations.
Soumya Roy Chowdhury.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Master of Arts in International Security Studies, Penelope Katsunu.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Master of Arts in Mass Communications, Claire Kirtland.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Manuela Isela.
Congratulations.
Kirk John Baptiste.
Congratulations.
Pitt San Low.
Congratulations.
Aisha Majinde Daddy. Diana Morris.
Congratulations.
Kirsty Padgett.
Congratulations.
Miak Sharma.
Congratulations.
Anja Stefan.
Congratulations.
Gareth Thomas.
Congratulations.
Wei Wei.
Congratulations.
Liu Yan.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Contemporary History, Elizabeth Bales.
Congratulations, thank you.
Jeffrey Barlow.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Catherine Barron. Nicholas Barry.
Congratulations.
Joseph Bruce.
Congratulations.
Robert Cahill.
Congratulations.
Emma Cliff.
Congratulations.
Harriet Dodds.
Congratulations.
Paul Farmelo.
Congratulations.
Glenn Giles.
Congratulations.
William Goodwin.
Congratulations.
David Green.
Congratulations.
Colin Griffith.
Congratulations.
Paul Harding. Katie Hardy. Gregory Heffer. Mark Hurst. Rebecca Kieber. Sean Keefe. Catherine Kidd. Tom Knowles. Philip Lane. Alexander Lewis. Grant Lloyd. Samantha McAvoy. Linda McIntosh. Ian Mitchell. George Morell. Philip Nolan. Richard Pegram. Judith Rich. Robert Smith. Andrew Tallis. Joseph Wesson. Winner of the Professor W. H. Brock Prize, Simon Williams. Emma Wright. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in International Relations, Karine Bambara. Olamide Barba. Edmund Brown. Shirley Chow. Alistair Kraft. Anthony Domonsky. Camilla Echeverria. James Keith. Winner of the Elsie and Barnett Janner Travel Scholarship and the R.L. Bothwick Prize, Christopher Levick. Winner of the Morris Hookham Prize, Thomas Maltby. Charlie Martin. Tomoyoshi Oates Noguchi. Nicholas Rowland. Sharon City. Sonia Soder. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in International Relations and History, David Adams. Michael Archer. Gerard Boyle. Harry Day. Catherine Goff. Laura McQuillan. For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Politics, Alex Becker. Rory Belcher. Craig Bickerton. Freya Booth. Bhakti Davi. Tara Devine. Damien Fretsam. Daniel Gibson. Thomas Hardy. Freya Hutton. Thomas Lamboy-Ngaba. Dominic Milnes.
Congratulations.
Ian Milner.
Congratulations.
Felicity Plowman.
Congratulations.
Lee Quilter.
Congratulations.
James Richards.
Congratulations.
Rochelle Shackies.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Jennifer Sherrard.
Congratulations.
Gurpreet Singh. Samuel Smout.
Congratulations.
Theodore Sangarides.
Congratulations.
Danny Vallejo.
Congratulations.
Simon Welband.
Congratulations.
Fenian Whitmore.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Chris Wilson. Sarah Wilson.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Bachelor of Science in Communications, Media and Society, Helen Amos.
Congratulations.
Susan Amos.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Simran Bara.
Congratulations.
Rupinder Bogal. Jennifer Cole.
Congratulations.
Michael Evans.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Faculty Prize, the Media and Communications Best BSc Dissertation Prize, and the Media and Communications Best BSc Level 3 Student Performance Prize, Qin Feng.
Well done on the prizes.
Faye Godfrey.
Congratulations.
Winner of the Media and Communications Best BSc Dissertation Prize, Emily Haycock.
Congratulations. Well done on the prize.
Rebecca Hazel.
Congratulations.
Lauren Howe.
Congratulations.
George Lamb.
Congratulations.
Mamta Manani.
Congratulations.
Andrew Miller.
Congratulations.
Sarah Mills.
Congratulations.
Kim Nguyen.
Congratulations.
Andrew Pearson. Eleni Pitsioris.
Congratulations.
Tom Sherman.
Congratulations.
Cheryl Thompson.
Congratulations. Thank you.
Timothy Voot.
Congratulations.
Linda Vikstrom.
Congratulations.
Tom Wharton.
Congratulations.
Kei Zhang.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Bachelor of Arts in Contemporary History, Adam Morrison.
Congratulations.
For the degree of Master of Arts in English Local History, Mika Hirosu.
Congratulations.
Well done. Alison Feary.
Congratulations. I'm a second of the game, sir. I thought it was good. Anyway, well done. Well done.
Mr. Vice Chancellor, I ask you to admit to the several degrees for which they are presented by my faculty those candidates who are absent.
By the authority of the Senate, I admit those candidates who are absent to the several degrees for which they are presented.
High Sheriff, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. Can I first of all echo the Vice-Chancellor's words early this morning in welcoming all of you here today to this congregation, especially the ranks of parents, friends, and families thronging the gallery and the hall here today. You're all most welcome. We're delighted to see you here. Because this is, above all, a day of celebration, and we are not going to let the odd shower or two put a dampener on that, are we? I hope not. So I'm going to be brief, because I suspect that all of our young graduates here want to rejoin families and begin, perhaps, pop the odd cork or two outside. But before I let you go, can I begin, first of all, by adding my warm personal congratulations to our two honorary graduates this morning, John Carter and Greville Janner. Gentlemen, you do us a great honor, a very great honor, in accepting our degrees, and it has been a particular pleasure for me to present them to you. It's always wonderful, particularly for the citizens of Leicester, to see men and women honored who have left such an imprint on our wonderful city and our university. You, Lord Janner, by your tireless championing of the underprivileged and community issues, and John, by your splendid sculpts, which will remain, I hope, forever and a day adorning the campus, I salute you both. However, I'm equally sure that our honorands will forgive me if I direct the remainder of my words today, to all of you who have graduated here in the faculties of the arts and the social sciences. It's very much your day, and I congratulate each and every one of you on the achievement in earning your degrees. You put a lot of hard work into it over many, many years, and I know you're keen to begin those celebrations I referred to earlier. Of course, as we've all seen, your pathways to graduation have been very diverse indeed, from history and archaeology of the ancient world to the more modern day interests of American studies and those inexorable twins, politics on the one hand and media and communications on the other. Your future career paths will be no doubt equally diverse. So what can I say that brings you all with such diversity together? I suspect that what unites you as a common factor is some form of appreciation of what you might term the broad sweep of history, how the lessons of the past are both acknowledged and more fundamentally understood in this complex world of ours today. You're obviously all familiar with the great English historian A.J.P. Taylor, who once remarked of Napoleon III, and I quote, "Like most of those who study history, he learned from the mistakes of the past how to make new ones." How true, if I may address it to our political graduates today, of much in the modern political world, and how unfortunate. I speak as a scientist, and science and medicine build generation to generation on discoveries and lessons once learned, absorbed forever. The law builds on the secure foundation of case studies, precedent, and judgment of the past. Perhaps, therefore, in our complex modern lives, with the influence of all of you here today, we will indeed begin to learn the lessons of history and apply them in our lives. Or maybe Oscar Wilde was right all along, when he quipped that the one duty we owe to history is to rewrite it. I'm sure, by the way, he would have been very at home in the media and communications group we've seen this morning. Now, all of this, I apologize, it's far too serious for a day of celebration. You have the rest of your lives in front of you, and yes, indeed, you will confront those challenges that my generation has bequeathed to yours. But if you approach those challenges with the humor, the fortitude of our two distinguished graduates today, I think that no challenge will be too much for you. After all, we have equipped you, I hope, at Leicester, with the powers of reason, thought, and logic. And we know that you will apply those in your everyday life and in what you do now in the rest of your career, and we will watch those careers with keen interest. You're alumni and alumni of our university and will remain so for the rest of your days. Your successes and your achievements will be shared here in Leicester. So enjoy your careers, enjoy above all the rest of the day, but in those long years to come, may I conclude above all by wishing you health and happiness. Thank you. I now declare this congregation closed.